Welcome, friends, to this second half of the one-day program we have once a month. I'm happy to see all of you again. And I mentioned in the morning the importance of seeking in your heart, in your mind, if you want to find the spiritual path through a perfect living master. It is not necessary to go outside anywhere. You can sit at home and do it. It has to be done with your internal seeking, not with the desire to get some worldly gain, but with the desire to go back home. Only if you feel that time has come for you to go back home. If you don't feel like it, then don't even try it. Just have a good time. But I want to tell you one thing. If you are a seeker and want to go back home and seek within your heart, even the remaining part of your life will undergo a change and you will find that you can make heaven upon this earth also. That's a very big change. You can make that change of converting this physical life with pain and pleasure and all the problems, all the disappointments, all the difficulties, you can make it into a heavenly place by seeking within and looking out as if you are watching a show. It is a show. It is a show that you are experiencing through your sense perceptions. Even today, scientists have realized that what they thought was absolute reality, physical reality, is only known to them or anybody else because of our perception. Whether you use a telescope or a microscope or see with these eyes, if you don't see in any way, you don't see, there's nothing existing. So what you see is what exists. When you can see more, more exists. That's how we have been discovering this world. So they are also accepting. It's our perception that is creating our reality. If you have one moment to look into the inner reality, how does this outer reality work? By going within and looking at how it operates. And then look out, you'll see you're projecting a show. It is like watching a movie. When you go and watch a movie in a theater, your eyes are fixed on the screen. Everything is happening there. You are very affected by it. You laugh, you cry. Bad things happen, good things happen on the screen. You don't leave your seat. You don't leave your chair to go and interfere in what is happening in the movie. Because you know it's a movie. Simple awareness that it's a movie makes you enjoy the good and the bad equally. It's just a movie. You identify with many characters. That is why you cry. That's why you laugh. But you know it's a movie, and knowing it's a movie helps you to not get involved with it. Not get into a fight with it. Not get into an interference with it. This is a movie. But we don't sit on our chairs. We run to the screen. We interfere. We get involved. Which is the chair from which we can see it as a movie? That chair we know in the theater, we buy a ticket and we go sit in our chair. Which is the chair that will make this life of ours a movie? That chair is right behind your eyes at what is called the third eye center. If you can practice only that much meditation, no more. Just the ability to close your eyes and see that you are not the body, you are sitting inside the body, in the head, on a nice chair. If you can do that much, you open your eyes and see from there. Don't see from the body, see from there. This will be a movie. As simple as that. When the world becomes a movie, you interfere in it, totally your life changes. There is one difference in this movie and the movie you see in the theater. In the theater, the actors who are taking part in the movie and which you see on the screen, those actors are separate from you. You are not one of the actors. In this movie, this body of yours is also one of the actors. And that's the difference. There you sit in a theater. Here you sit in one of the characters of the movie. This body of yours is also one of the characters in the movie that is happening outside. So you can't say that the rest is movie and I am not. You're also part of the movie. But the one sitting inside is not part of the movie. The one that can sit behind the eyes at third eye center is not part of the movie. That's the witness of the movie. And if you do that, you're in the same state as you watch a movie in the theater. After all, when we are sitting in the theater, nobody looks back to see how the pictures are coming. Nobody is seeing. We are all involved in what is happening on the screen. Nobody is even aware at that time. We forget at that time that it is merely a shadow created by a projector behind us. There's nothing in front. The film is loaded into a projector and the film has been made earlier. It is not made that day. It is not being made when you are watching. It was made earlier. It is put in the projector behind. The light behind the projector is throwing the shadow through the projector on a screen. This is identical with our situation. If we go inside, not outside, go within, behind. If we go behind where we think we are and go inside, we will see that our mind is a projector. And the mind is loaded with a film that was made earlier, not today. That what we are seeing is not happening now. It happened earlier. We are seeing it now. We are experiencing it now. The whole of our destiny, which makes us feel it's happening now, we are taking decisions now, we are making choices now, is because we are sitting in one of the characters. They're supposed to make decisions now. But the movie was not made today. Movie was made earlier, film. That is why the movie will remain the same no matter how hard you try, unless you want to change the film from inside at the level of the mind. Then you can change it. But so long as you don't go to the projector and change the film, it'll be the same. The light that goes through the projector is the light of the soul. The light is soul. Soul throw the light through the mind. The mind has a prarabdha destiny filmed into it, and we see a movie. Now, this is not a theoretical proposition I'm making to you. I am saying check it out. And does not require that you have to go to many levels of consciousness. It only requires you go inside where a third eye exists. Third eye is not a very difficult place to find, because when you look at these two eyes, which are looking outside, these two eyes are combining two images, and that is why you create stereoscopic effect of distance. If you see with one eye, it becomes difficult. With two eyes, it looks there are some people near, some far, so you make a distance. The distance is being created by two images merging together. Where are they merging? When you're looking at things with the physical eyes, where are you seeing from? Have you ever thought of it? If you are not seeing from the eyes, you would see two images. Where is the merger taking place that the two images combine, and inside the head, you're opening the eyes and seeing one image because they're merged? The merger is at the same place which we call third eye. No different place. Third eye is already the place from where we function. When we close our eyes and think about something, where do we think from? Something is happening in the head. We can even recall our thoughts going in. Thoughts are in language, in words, and a special thought is going, and we can close eyes. Where is it working? Where is the thought coming from? Same third eye center. Supposing you want to know that if you are not a physical body, you are just one point of consciousness. Where is that point? Again, close your eyes and figure out, are you in your hands, in your arms, in your legs, in your feet, in your heart? Where are you? You come back. You are behind the eyes, because that's where you are opening eyes and seeing. Therefore, you are a third eye center. You are right now a third eye center. You are never away from third eye center. And yet we keep on saying, go to third eye center. You're already there. Then what is the meaning of saying that good meditation means going to third eye center, sitting there and watching the world as a movie? What it means is our attention is scattered. Our attention is scattered all over. That is why we are not thinking of where we are. We lose awareness of where we are. We think of outside things. We associate all our activities of the self as belonging to the body. If somebody were to say, where are you sitting? I'll say, this chair. I won't say, my body is sitting in this chair. I am sitting inside the body, behind my eyes. I won't say that, although the truth is that if I'm not the body, I'm sitting behind the eyes. That is why it is not a case of going to a third eye center. Meditation is withdrawing your attention from everything else to your own self. And your own self is already where it's supposed to be. So third eye center should not be taken to be a very subtle place that you have to search for it. Because people close their eyes in meditation and they try to make a picture of themselves. That little picture of themselves, because head is small, they make a little picture, say, where am I? I'm sitting now. I'm maybe in third eye, maybe. Do you know that picture is not you at all? You're making it up. Where are you? Where you're watching that picture from? With closed eyes, you're looking at a picture. You are that which is looking at the picture. And these are not these eyes that are looking at the picture. Something inside you is looking at that picture. That's where you are. When you become conscious that where are you looking at every picture around you, everything happening around you, you will find you can turn your head inside, look right, left, behind. It is not these eyes at all. There is a form of you which you haven't looked at too carefully. That is inside. If you look carefully, supposing you sit inside, say, I know I am here and the rest of my head is around me, the body is below me, I am here. What am I doing? What do I look like? Do I have hands? Do I have arms? You will have everything. You will notice you have a replica of this body right inside you. And that body has the capacity to see, to touch, to smell, to hear. It has all the sense perceptions that this body we think has. Actually, this body has no sense perception. If that were not there, this body can never see, never touch, never smell, never hear anything. It is the internal body's sense perceptions that are making this body function and have those experiences. And yet we don't see who we are inside. I'm not talking of Atma or soul or anything. I am talking of the very first step of discovering that there is a part of us, a more real part of us, that is making this body alive. And they're sitting inside us. People say, that man died, his soul went to another place. Soul never goes anywhere. Soul has never traveled anywhere. Soul has remained in its sachkhand always. Soul creates experiences that move around it. When they say, this soul went to another place, they're talking of that inner body. Sukshma sharir, astral body. Astral body contains all the sense perceptions. We also call it sensory body. And all the sense perceptions are intact. You will see in the meditation sessions that I hold, that we do exercises where you can, with the inner body, have all the experiences and much more. For example, you can fly with that body. It has no gravity. It is a very, very body that you can just feel anytime when you know you are not this physical body, but you are inside. Now, why am I pointing this out is that if you want to do quality meditation with love and devotion, it should be done with that body. That's why I'm saying. You want to make a head start into getting inner experiences, it should start from that body, not from this one. So long as you think this is the body in which you are meditating, you'll be held up for a very long time. To withdraw attention from this body is very difficult, but if you start from there, it's easier. I'm just giving a tip, practical tip, for those who do actual meditation and want to have inner visions and inner experiences. That's how you can do it. Otherwise, it becomes a sort of blind faith that one day we will get something. We have got Namdan, we got initiation from a guru, we will get something one day. No verification. Almost we convert such a beautiful opportunity into blind faith. It's a good thing to verify from time to time. Is there any truth in these things? Is it somebody's story that they have written? That there are different levels of experiences? Or are they accessible to us while we are here as human beings? They're all accessible to us as human beings. Only question of practice. The practice makes us perfect. And practice with that kind of thing which pulls us in. Not merely practice where we have to push all the time. Our meditation is pushing. Nothing pulls. But when we start with that body and with love and devotion, we are pulled from inside. There are two factors that pull us inside. One is when you meditate with love and devotion and you have a living guru, a living friend with higher awareness in your physical external life. And he is giving you unconditional love which you can recall and experience inside. When you do meditation, that's a big pull. You can try it out. The other pull is a pull from the self. A pull from your own self. Because we don't know what the self is. The self emanates a kind of a radiance, emanates something which is like a sound. When we hear about the word that was with God, word made everything, and we call a guru word made flesh, when we say that the Shabad is creating everything, the Shabd is dharti, Shabd akash, Shabd is Shabad maya prakash, the Shabad came out of Shabad. Where is that Shabad? We are not talking of a song. We are not talking of kirtan outside. We are talking of an inner Shabad. Where is that? The truth is, consciousness itself of the self generates that Shabad, generates that song, generates that music. It can be heard. Anybody can hear it. You have to just turn your attention inward, not ears, attention. Put your attention inside, you will see your own self is ringing inside and can be heard. It changes because it is not a sound. It becomes a sound when you are in physical body. That is why they use the word Shabad, Bani, word, Ismailahi, all kinds of words have been used in every religion. They're all representing the same thing. That there is something coming out of our own self, our own consciousness, which in the physical plane can be heard by us. That is why they use these words, because it's audible. It can be heard. Here at least it can be heard. Later on it becomes even more powerful. It's beyond hearing. But it still is the same power of the self, of consciousness, of the soul. This resonance can be heard if you can put your attention sufficiently inside. You can watch the show outside earlier, but to put the attention enough to hear that sound that comes from yourself, not a sound that is coming from the body, sound from the bloodstream, sound from the breathing, sound from the heartbeat, not that sound. These are internal bodily physical sounds. But when you hear the sound of your own consciousness, it has a pull. Very good pull. It sweeps you off your feet. It is the fastest way to see your inner self by vacating the consciousness of the body. These are two things that pull us inside. If you practice meditation like that, the quality of meditation improves. And you can personally verify all the statements that have been made in all the scriptures. You can verify what they meant. You can verify why they were said like this. You can verify what the instruction in them means. Otherwise, our mind is constantly interpreting and giving different interpretations all the time. Mind can't have that experience. Mind can write about it, can read about it, can describe it in some way, to some extent. Experience is something different. They say that the inner experience is like a dumb guy eating a candy. And you say, how was the candy? He says, because he's dumb. We are like that. Inner experience is not so easy to explain because it sweeps you off, makes you see the world entirely differently. Here we are thinking that the world around us is real, has been there for a long time. We were born and we are now a small part. After some years, 100 years or 90 years or some time, we will go away. And the world will still be here. That's what we believe. We all believe that because we believe in the reality of this world. When you find from inside that the world is being created by you, it does not exist. When you die, it withdraws and finishes. When you come, it again regenerates itself. Then it's a show being projected from inside. How would you explain anything to anybody? Nobody will understand you. If you try to explain too much, they will lock you up in the madhouse, something like that. That is why even these masters, with all the knowledge and enlightenment, they have told us in the form of stories. They make little stories so we can understand it. But they say the proof of the pudding lies in the eating. Go within and find out and check out. This is a very practical path. Don't convert even a pure spiritual path into another religion. We have done it again and again throughout history. Let's not do it again and take full advantage of a practical method of discovering who we are, where we belong, where we should be, what this all show is about. It's very easy to do it. First step is to seek inside. Let the friends appear in your life who will hold your hand and with his unconditional love convince you who he is. Then practice and find the same friend inside. And before that, have other experiences more joyful than outer experiences, and the whole world will become a movie. This is the spiritual path. Spiritual path is not a blind belief, one day good things will happen, I have faith in this thing. That is blind faith. But to be able to check all these things, personal experience, that's the spiritual path. So I hope you will make this teaching or a particular spiritual path or journey into a practical one and your practical experience into it. I would like to take up a few questions if they have been asked. Don, you don't have Jonathan. Is Jonathan here?
When a soul is going to be reborn in a human body, who or what draws from one's sentient pool of karma to formulate the product karma of the next lifetime? Does the individual soul participate and have a say in this?
I will read the question again. When a soul is going to be reborn in a human body, who or what draws one's sentient pool of karma to formulate the prarabdha karma of the next lifetime? Does the individual soul participate or have a say in this? Soul has no karma. Never had. Never will. Soul is not bound by karma. When soul, for the sake of experience, takes on a mind, the mind creates karma. The mind creates time and space. The mind creates events, and the mind places those events on a timeline, and we move on those events with the mind, and when we identify with the mind, we think we have karma. Soul has no karma. Therefore, we are born by an automatic process based upon the events which are laid down, based upon cause and effect, which is the law of karma. That if you do good, you will be rewarded. If you do bad, you are punished. And who decides whether it's good or bad? Your own mind. The mind, with its conscience, sits inside to decide which is good, which is bad. Who decides what is good or bad? Who trains the mind to determine good and bad? Society, religion, upbringing, parents, wherever the soul, mind, and a sense is complex, has taken birth. That is what determines. What determines where you will take birth? A previous life or a series of previous lives. When it is series of previous lives, we call those accumulated karma sinchit karma, reserve karma. So we pull out from the reserve karma and bring out a prarabdha and come here. And in prarabdha, we go through the process of making choices, and then that creates the next life, and this becomes karma and karma. Some of it can be accommodated in a future life, some cannot be. It goes again into sinchit. Sinchit is a very huge reserve of karma. Question is, if soul has no karma and only came to have this experience without karma, where did it get the first karma to start with? Where did the soul, as a person, as a being that made a choice, where did that happen? So when you study different levels of consciousness, you come to see that the soul, in order to have experience of time and space, entered what was given to it as a universal mind, in which all karma of all kinds, all possible combinations and permutations of different events and karma of lives was placed there. The soul had an opportunity to make a choice. It went through the choice and looked at, I am going to have a new experience. I am going to have a new ride in an amusement park. Should I go on the roundabout or should I go on the Ferris wheel? I have a choice. Soul made a choice. After seeing the lives that are available to go in, soul picked up one life of a human being. But that life could not exist without previous karma. So the life that was picked up had previous karma. Not that the soul had lived through it. It was part of the causation of that particular one life. Soul came on one life and simultaneously had all number of previous lives. Why? Because that life can't be made up without karma. The purpose of karma was to create one life, but it had to be justified by previous lives which the soul never had experience of. But once it got into one life, the problem created by the previous life, which was not lived even, but the shadow life, created this one life. Then in this one life, the soul participating with the mind began to make choices which led to the next life. Can we see all this? Is it possible to see all this? Of course it is. By reversing the process of coming back to see these experiences, we go withdraw within ourselves, raise our consciousness to the level of what we call the causal plane or trikuti, where this choice was made. And you can there see how the choice was made by yourself and how you chose one piece and the rest of it was part of it. Not only the past lives, even future lives were part of it. Because the choices you were going to make were also fixed at that point. So it was a show where you went to see where the whole film was completely loaded. You just picked up one DVD out of a series and decided to play it. This life we are leading is play of that one DVD. Why did we pick up a DVD that is so poor? Sometimes we are born poor, born sick, and had so much trouble in this life. How could we be so unintelligent, stupid to say, to pick up this kind of a life? The reason was simple. First of all, what we do is not real. It's just a show. Second was that we saw that one life we go into will lead to many other lives, and in one of those lives we already made arrangements that we'll find the means to go back to our true home. We love that. We said, what a wonderful life we have picked up, that although we go through all these experiences of up and down, but one day we'll be able to go back. This was seen by us when we picked up the first DVD. All the DVD was not one life. It was infinite past lives, infinite future lives. We jumped into the middle in one life and we go out of the middle, then all the other lives are still sitting here. So that is why, who chose this? The question is, who draws the Sinchit pool to make our life? We draw it ourselves. We have drawn it in advance. We don't draw it now. We have drawn in advance. But what is the mechanism of doing it while we are here? That is what we did originally and set up all our destinies in advance. But when we are here and we say our karma is leading to this thing, our actions now are leading to this thing. So we have become local people, local citizens, and now we follow local law that we should be doing good, then we get good results, we should be doing bad, we'll be punished. This law we are operating now here. But when we die, then who determines that we will be taking this problem next time and rest will go into Sinchit? We arranged an outside agency. An outside agency and put one of the souls with the karma of that soul to be that agent who should be doing this. In Indian literature, they call him Dharmraj, angel of death. That when you die, that we appear before an angel, appear before an entity that makes us look at our life at death, very quickly we see the whole life backwards. That means we see just what happened before we die, all the way till our birth, and everything shines up. And the angel of death says, this is your karma, this is what you have to do, but I can pick up these elements from third previous life, tenth previous life, hundredth previous life. That's what happens. So we have ourselves placed our experience in the superintendence of an angel of death. And that's how the system is operating. When I was young and was practicing this meditation in an elementary way, this point puzzled me very much. The point that puzzled me was that how can the angel of death, even with the best of computers that he may be having, decide that this person had a karma with A, B, C, D, and he is putting another life where you have to pay back that karma with the same A, B, C, D. That means he has to work with the karma of so many people to integrate them. How is it possible? We meet thousands of people in our life. Is that guy who is sitting to determine our next problem, he is sitting with a computer and is finding out the life of the thousands of people, so we interact and we meet again? It was a big puzzle for me. Much later I realized that these people are made up by us. And we make up the same people again to pay off the karma. They are not even involved. They have their own set of experiences. That these are unique experiences. And that's very difficult to understand unless you really see the process by which these experiences are created from within. So long as they look like they're outside, it's very difficult to explain how we interact and integrate these different experiences with different people to create a new karma. But once it is done, we have our next life. The rest goes into sinchit. It's a normal pattern. We have been going through this over and over again. And this itself can be verified. If you go to the causal stage in meditation, second stage in meditation, you can see all the past lives which you have actually lived and the past lives that were notional and created those lives which you never lived. You can also see the future lives that you never lived and never will live because you will go out. This is just a pattern here. And it's verifiable through meditation inside. These are all possible sources of our total awareness, total knowledge, sitting inside. No outside helping, no regression. Don't have to go to somebody else for past life regression. They can make stories and convince you. But when you go inside, you actually see your own past, your own future. Everything can be seen inside. Then you realize how the show is all set up. What happens when one is initiated by a perfect living master, a Satguru? He is operating from beyond the mind. He is operating from beyond this system of karma. When he says, I am your friend, we will go together to our true home, to Sachkhand, he bypasses the system. So when an initiate, a friend, accepted friend of a perfect living master dies, neither the angels of death come, nor the Dharmaraj comes, nor do you appear before anybody, your own master appears. And he places you which is most appropriate for your journey back home, not for just perpetuating the law of karma. So what does he do? How does he manage this? When he accepts you and says, I accept you, I initiate you, and the perfect living master says that, he burns and destroys the entire sanchit karma right there and then. There's no possibility to pick up elements from any other life of the past except the life you're living now. So if he feels that you need to do more of the exercise because you're going on a spiritual journey, spiritual path as you have believed in. So if he feels you have to be here again, he follows the same law of karma. He says, all right, you can have one more life and finish your work. That life will always be better than this one because it's only based upon the karma of one life. No previous life is involved. It'll always be better. You can't pick up anything from elsewhere. Normally, he won't do that. If you follow the simple instructions to the best of your ability, of your master, of your Sadguru. If you follow these simple instructions, you will never be born again. You will go. If any karma has to be paid off of this life that you created, it will be paid off in the next higher stage. It can be paid off. Karma is created only in wakeful human life. It can't be created anywhere else. Animals don't create it. Trees and plants don't create it. Insects don't create it. Birds don't create it. Angels don't create it. Only human beings who think they have a choice to make create it with that experience of free will, free choice making. Out of 8.4 species recorded in our old scriptures, 84 lakh, 8.4 million, only one species out of that creates karma and all the rest pay off. We can create so much karma in one life that we can take thousands of lives to pay off. How is that? That is because karma is not created by action. Karma is created by intention to act. When you intend to act something in your head, karma is created. When you act upon it, more karma is created. So therefore, since our mind is constantly making plans, do this, do that, do this, I want to kill that person, you don't kill him, but you've created karma. Karma is very quickly created by us and our mind, and that is why we create so much and we create a reservoir of the sinchit karma. But once you are initiated by a perfect living master, you don't have to go through that. He appears and he only puts you if you are not able to follow his instructions in that particular life. If you totally ignore and go away, only then you may have to come again another life. If you go against him, if you kill your master, you may have to come third, fourth life. It's not that every time you have to come so many times. If you follow instructions to the best of your ability, they may not be perfect, none of us are perfect. To the best of our ability, if we do it, we don't come back again. So that is why this automatic mechanism of making of karma were designed by us, working automatically.
Is it true that if my first guru has not manifested inside me before leaving his body, then I am not fully initiated by him and must seek another master?
Is it true that if my first guru has not manifested inside me before leaving his body, then I am not fully initiated and must seek another master? That is not true. When the master, perfect living master, initiates us, he places himself inside us immediately. It's not that when you manifest that he is there. You manifest and experience him. But he is there for day one. You can have a feeling he is there because we are not used to withdrawing our attention. That's why we don't see him. But we can feel, we can talk, we can have conversation. And he, at the time of initiation, also gives us instructions how to avoid the mind pretending to be the master. Otherwise, the mind can keep on speaking and saying, I am master, you can't see me, but I am hiding, I am the master. But at the time of initiation, the perfect living master gives us a method. These are methodologies generally employed by masters, that they give you a means to check if it is your mind pretending, if it is the real master. If your mind pretends to become the master in your meditation and you use that method of checking, which is normally a small mantra or something, you check that, the image disappears immediately. It cannot sustain. The perfect living master in his physical body is ordinary person. But when you meditate, you will notice that his eyes and his forehead represent something different because they cannot be sustained or made up by the mind, even if you try. So when you see them and check with the method he's told, the master is there. So the manifestation of the inner form of the master or the radiant form of the master may take time. But the master is there from day one and the initiation is always complete. If it doesn't, if you haven't manifested in the entire life, he may give you another life. If he gives you another life, then of course, in the physical body, the master is dead, you are also dead, and new master will come in your life. Therefore, the master who gave you initiation, perfect initiation, prevented any negative power or Kal or Dharmraj or anybody to interfere with you, but the arrangement is that you will find another master later on. Similarly, if they, in the same life it happens that you have not made progress in one master and you are pulled by another master, you may take on another surrender because you could not see the first master, you could not have contact with him the way you wanted. Second, you can have. This also happens. Sometimes it happens that the master who initiates you is not a perfect master. And he is at a different category. He is a master. He takes you within, but it takes you a different level. All the heavens that we know of are only in the astral plane. Masters take us to heaven and say, this is Sachkhand, this is your true home. There's no way to check it. It looks like true home. Of course it is in time and space, like this one. We don't go beyond the mind, it's within the mind. But it looks like heaven, our true home. But if your seeking goes beyond that, another master will come in your life and take you further. It's automatic arrangement. It's all based upon the seeking of the soul. And you can have a series of masters. In fact, our scriptures say that there are always more than one master. The mother is the first master who brings you up. The school teacher is the next master who brings you up. The teacher in the religion is the next master who brings you on this path. And the spiritual master comes last of all. And there may be a series of spiritual masters depending upon how far they take you. So one should not worry too much about this. One should keep on seeking the truth that they want inside. If you want to seek the truth of such kind of your true home where you belong, you will go there. Even if there are a series of masters that come. So initiation is a guarantee. It's a guarantee by the master on whose list you are that you are going back. Now I always say to distinguish between those who have not completed their course as it were and have to come to second life. That the perfect living master who initiates them first time puts you either on list A or B. List A, he will take you in the same life. He is your last final master. List B, you have been initiated by perfect living master fully. But since you have not completed, another master will come who will be putting you on list A. First one will put you on list B. That happens. So many of the disciples of masters who are initiated by them are on list A or B. So A means same life, they will go back, and B means that they will probably not be able to complete the following of instructions. It's a local show, it's a local drama following local rules. These are local rules about trying to do things, trying to work for something, trying to struggle for things. So the same rules are being applied only at these lower levels. This does not constitute true spirituality. True spirituality is when you cross the mind and go beyond the mind. These are methods to take you halfway, one quarter way, and then ultimately you go back home.
Final question for today. Can we skip further questions and do a meditation?
Can we skip further questions and do meditation? Who would like to do meditation instead of questions? Let's meditate. Let's do the basic meditation. Basic meditation is to consider this body of yours as your house in which you live. This is not you. You're living in this house. It has six floors. Why six floors? Because the energy centers are divided into six. And they control the body and control the environment around us. That is why we call it a house with six floors, based upon the six chakras, energy chakras below the eyes. You go, close your eyes, go behind the eyes and imagine that you are sitting in the sixth floor of this house in the center. From there, you visualize how the house is made up and the six floors are all below you. You are at the top in the sixth floor, sitting in the center of the sixth floor level. A room in which you have a nice chair, cushion, ground, whatever you like to sit on. Don't think of anything else except where you are sitting, what is happening around you. If any pictures come in front of you, ignore them. Let them move and pass. They will come and move sideways. Let them go. If any other thought comes, put your attention back on where you are sitting. What are you doing there? Try to push yourselves further back in the head so that you are in the center. You can use your feet to push yourself back, the inner feet at the sixth floor. Make sure you feel you are in the center of the head. If you have a master, invite him to come and join you. If you have a beloved person you love, invite that person to come and meet you there in the sixth floor. And have a place ready for the beloved master or your beloved friend to come and sit there. Have a conversation inside. No other thought, nothing outside, only what is happening inside. If you have a mantra or simran or any words to repeat, repeat them slowly while you're sitting there. Repeat very slowly and listen to what you are repeating. Keep repeating while you welcome your friend. Do not move forward. Stay in the center. Thank your master, thank your friend for the good things you have got from your friend. Think of the good things you got and thank. Express your gratitude. Have a nice conversation. Don't think of anything else except this. Keep your eyes closed till I count five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Open your eyes and welcome back. How many of you enjoyed this short session? I'm very happy. Normally people don't enjoy meditation. But that's a good sign. Because this is not mechanical. This is with love and devotion makes all the difference. Well, thank you very much for joining me today here.